Welcome to A Reason for Hope, your question connection with the entire Word of God. We would love for you to join in our conversation. Simply follow us on our Facebook page at Calvary Christian Fellowship of Tucson. If you have a question, email or text us at questionsforhope@gmail.com. Now here's your host, pastor, author, and Bible teacher Scott Richards, along with his right-hand man, Sean Richards.
Well, a very good afternoon to you, and welcome to this edition of A Reason for Hope. Continued prayers for Pastor Scott. He will be joining us hopefully next week, but as things currently stand, we are joined today, as per usual, on Mondays by Peter Martin. Thank you for joining us today, Peter.
Yeah, great to be here, man.
And, of course, in starting our Apologetics Mondays, we're going to be discussing positive confession and whether or not that actually falls in line with Scripture. But before we get into all of that, I want to make sure that you can send us in your questions, whether it's on or beyond that topic. As long as it involves God's Word, it's open and available for you here. If you have sincere questions concerning God's inspired Word, just feel free to give us a call at 1-877-556-1212. That's 1-877-556-1212. If you prefer email, questionsforhope@gmail.com is available to you. You can tweet us at ScottR4H. You can follow us on YouTube at A Reason for Hope. But the main ministry media place where you can access our live stream and follow us along live, as well as leave your comments during the broadcast, will be on Facebook. Calvary Christian Fellowship of Tucson is where you can join us, and we'd love to see you there. Before we start speaking more words, let's make sure that God's the one giving them to us. Dad, thank you that we have the honor of sharing your word here today. We just want to invite your Spirit to not only replace our own hearts, but fully demonstrate yours. Allow your people to hear your words, your voice, and most of all, just take more of you away from this as a result. We're honored to be a part of the process and pray that we would be the first ones to receive of that fruit. We pray this in your name. Amen. All right, so positive confession. Obviously, it sounds like a positive thing. Otherwise, they'd call it negative confession, though that's another topic. The verses that they would use to support this whole issue aren't unfounded on their own. Say, for example, when Jesus said in Matthew regarding prayer that God will supply everything for your need. In Philippians chapter 4, we read that God will supply all of your needs. And of course, we should ask in faith, no doubting. James chapter 1, right? All of these passages seem to suggest that there is power in prayer. Now, myself and you, we would not dismiss that principle. However, when it comes to being broadcast in this sort of light and saying that, oh, well, therefore, God is essentially the means to get anything that you want out of this life, that the desires of your heart are given to you by God and the means to acquire them are also able to be given to you by God. You just have to be willing to confess them. And then also in the negative stat, the negative confession principle is that you can curse yourself if you constantly tell or remind yourself in faith that things are bad, things are terrible, that I am poor, that I am dumb, that the power of God in you as an image bearer of God is causing these things to happen in your life. So if we learn to be more positive, which again, we're in favor of on at face value, where then do you think they got off the boat, so to speak, when it comes to this idea of, therefore, if I come to God with my request, he will fulfill them because I asked? Yeah. Where's the issue here?
So the issue with this idea of positive versus negative confession is kind of like what we talked about in our little study on prosperity teaching, which is where this comes from.
Yeah, very intertwined.
Yeah, very intertwined, is that it insinuates that God is not sovereign over things. It insinuates that, in essence, God is kind of, he's not really on the throne. He's more or less somewhat sovereign. He's somewhat ruling and reigning, but you are almost ruling and reigning in a similar capacity. Because you think about it, if you have 7 billion people on the planet, each one of them with the ability to change God's mind or change the way he's going to be acting at any point in time in history, God is not actually ruling and reigning. He is actually being moved by the whims of man.
Yeah, it's like Bruce Almighty all over again.
Right, exactly. Right. For those of you guys who didn't see it, Jim Carrey gets the powers of God. And he decides to just answer everyone's prayers in the affirmative, and it ends up destroying the world, basically.
Well, his town.
His town, right. So in the same light, that would be kind of what we're looking at, that with humanity being able to have different whims and different desires, that means that anyone praying in faith, anyone desiring things from God who is a legitimate born-again Christian can move the mind of God. And that is kind of a scary thought. And I think that many pastors have pointed this out and given a very good illustration. Imagine for a second, for those of you guys who are listening, imagine for a second that God came to you tonight and he said, you know what I'm going to do? Every prayer request that you made in faith when you were 11 years old, I'm going to grant right now. How many of you guys would actually want God to do that? Now, if you're a thinking person and you're anything like me, you'll look back and you'll say, I wouldn't really want God to do that. The reason why is because most 11-year-olds are stupid. They just don't know it yet. You know, like when I was 11 years old, I was an idiot. I did not think I was an idiot at that time. I thought I was really, really smart. But you are. You don't really know what you want at that age. You don't really know what's good for you at that age. And therefore, if God gave you everything you asked for at 11 years old, you would make a wreck and ruin of your life. Well, how about this? Okay, so you're like, oh, 11's stupid. Okay, fine. How about 16, right? For those of you guys who are in your 20s and 30s, what if God granted you everything you wanted when you were 16 years old right now? Once again, if you're a thinking person, you'll look back and you'll say, no, I was still kind of an idiot when I was 16. I don't think I'd want God to give me everything I wanted back then right now. And if that's true for 11 and 16, why wouldn't that be true right now? Don't you think in 10 or 15 years, you'll look back at the things that you want so desperately right now and you'll say, maybe God was right to not give me those things. And I'm not even talking about the minor things of career, who you want to marry, things like that, which are major things, but I'm even talking about the more massive things. How do you know with you, who does not have an eternal perspective like God, even the more desperate things of your heart that you might be wanting for God to, say, heal something in you or in someone that you love? How do you know that your desires are superior to the desires of an omnipotent, omniscient being, right? If God truly knows best, wouldn't you want his will over yours? Why would you want for God's will to be usurped by your own, right? Which is what positive and negative confession seem to be saying. It seems that God's will, God has like a desire, and that's usually how I hear it put. God has like a desire, but you can either have something less than what God desires for you or something more than what God wants for you based on how you use your confession. And that's a very scary thought process. That means that you can actually take away from or add to God's plan for your life based on the way that you think and the way that you act. Again, if you're a thinking person, you'll look at that and you'll say, I don't like that idea of the universe. I would like more the idea of Romans 8, where he says, we don't know how we should pray, but thank God that the Holy Spirit is interceding for us. Meaning that Paul is saying, hey, prayer matters, prayer counts. However, isn't it great that you do have an omnipotent, omniscient, meaning all-knowing God who knows what's best for you and is doing what's right for you in all circumstances and all situations? Isn't it great that God sometimes says no, as well as the times that he says yes? And that's the perspective that we get from the Bible. We don't necessarily get the perspective that God is going to do everything that we ask if we do certain rituals, or if we have enough faith, or if we have enough positivity in our lives. That's not really the picture we get from the Bible, and praise God that it is. You know, I would be very terrified to live in a universe where God's will can be usurped by man. That would be a very scary place to be.
Yeah, and so again, when we're talking about these biblical issues, they can quote these verses, but in practice, it just doesn't make sense.
Right.
Now, if my interpretation of Scripture makes reality silly, either Scripture is silly or my interpretation is silly. And the best thing to do when double-checking your biblical homework is, of course, to keep reading. Say, for example, the passage that we quoted in Philippians chapter 4. Or I quoted anyway. We won't drag you along with this. When someone says, oh, well, Paul himself said to the Philippian church, Philippians chapter 4 and verse 18, my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. Well, plainly, that says that God's going to give us everything that we need.
True.
Wait a minute. Yeah. Everything that we need, right. Not everything that we, as it's oftentimes said, greed. Yeah. If I want something, does that get it? Or if I need something, who determines that? Who
right.
knows what I actually need?
Right.
And in any set of circumstances, if I'm going to say, well, my needs are my desires, they're interchangeable, and we live in this society, what I want or how I feel, that determines my identity, and you should go to prison if you don't recognize that now. Well, here's the interesting thing. In the same chapter, if that's going to be your takeaway from Philippians chapter 4 and verse 18 and 19. Well, let's stay in the same chapter, by the way, and see how Paul ultimately took away things from his Christian life. In verse 11 of chapter 4, He said, "Not that I speak in regard to need, for I have learned in what state I am to be full." No, content. "I know how to be abased." And by the way, that word literally means to have less, right? To be considered less. "And I know how to abound," which is what we love. "Everywhere in all things, I have learned both to be full and, unfortunately, to be hungry." How to be, how to abound and to suffer need. But notice this, "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Mm. Context is king. Mm. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, but what is the context of that verse? Mm. First and foremost, regarding 19, I think you should start in verse 11. In fact, you probably start in verse 1 of chapter 1 before making conclusions. But the idea here is, oh, well, God will give me everything that I need. Exactly. Let's take that at face value. Are your needs your greeds? Are those the same thing? Well, why is it wrong to want, say, for example, your dad to be healed from cancer? Mm-hmm. Or, I won't give other examples for the sake of confidentiality, but here's the issue. If I'm going to then take that passage and say this is how it applies, what about the same chapter where it... Paul the Apostle, God's man in this situation, you used to speak. You can't say you didn't have faith. Mm. But on the other hand, he says, hey, in God, through Christ, I can suffer and rejoice. I can have a lot and a little. Now, we prefer to have a lot. We prefer to rejoice, but life is this way. And so we need to be able to balance that. And in the same way, in Matthew chapter 6, the same statement where they say that anything you ask in the Father will be given to you, same chapter, Jesus says, "Set up not up your treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and thieves break in and steal, but set up your treasure in heaven, where these things don't take place." You see the inconsistency there. If the same chapter of my proof text for these things make no sense, then maybe I'm the one speaking nonsense. Right. So the doctrine of positive confession, we would not say it's a biblical one, though they use a biblical to prove it. That doesn't necessarily mean that it is true. And the good way, the best way, by the way, in dealing with people who are caught up with these sort of things, and Peter, you know this from experience, is not to call them heretics and anathema and cast them out from the body as infidel and an unbeliever. We should be gracious with them, patient with them, and understand that the desire for good things is a good thing. But like you said, a proper view of God essentially throws this issue out the window. Let them get to know Jesus more and say, you know, I kind of want more what he wants for my life. Yeah. Because as, well, theologically poor as Bruce Almighty starring Jim Carrey right. was, the movie ended on a good point, right? It was, I want you to decide what's right for me.
Right.
That's the point. If we know God, we'll be more willing to trust him. And by saying things in faith, they're on the right track. Mm-hmm. We should trust God and we should bring our prayers to him, trusting, but trusting what?
Right.
Him or us.
Right.
And that's the key. So down, two thumbs down for positive confession, but understand as well, the people that are usually caught up in this are wanting good things. So in order to get their eyes off of good things, we need to point them to the best thing.
Right.
And that, of course, is the person of Jesus Christ. So for those of you who are interested in these sort of issues, Got Questions has an excellent article on these sort of things. Look up Got Questions, Positive Confession. They can go through these passages with you in detail. And if you have further questions on it, we'll be happy to receive them. But speaking of the things that are most important, we got a question here from Mike who wants to know how he can know that he's saved. He has an issue with knowing that his faith is actually trusting Christ in a saving way, because quite frankly, when we examine all of our own faith, yours and mine included, it reaches a downward point at some point. There's a limit to it. So Mike wants to know, how do I know that my faith in Christ actually saves me, that I'm not just fooling myself? Well, Mike, you're in good company, because when Jesus was off to do something very important regarding the deliverance of a demonically possessed child, something that was definitely a good thing, he uses the same term in regarding faith. If you believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And obviously, Jesus' number one priority was your salvation. Go to Mark chapter 9 and verses 23 through 25. Read the whole context, but note the Father's response. He says, "Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief." Now, if I'm going to take this apart piecemeal and apply it to the rest of the Bible, we have a fine example of a man who had every reason to trust Jesus could deliver his child. His followers had done it before, he had done it before, and the prophets, who have done the same things in the name of the same God, had done this all before. Likewise, when he saw the evil that was in front of him, the work of the enemy that it had inflicted on his family, and again, we aren't told the reasons why. This is just something that goes wrong and that God did something about, by the way. But you ask the question, why then couldn't this man or even the disciples' faith save him? It fell short at a certain point, right? Well, how did they deal with that? They brought it to Jesus, and he was willing to even use a man who recognized he had a lack of faith. Is that correct?
That's right.
So if salvation then is, as we remember in Ephesians 2, 8 through 9, by faith, not by works, lest any man should boast. If trusting in who God is and what he did to prove it, Romans 10, 9 through 10, is how the salvation process begins and ends for all of us. If we abide in a relationship with Jesus, and how is that done? John chapter 6, that you believe in him whom he has sent. It all stands or falls on this one key feature. Does it involve me or does it involve God? Because if it involves me, we're going to end up in verse 24. Help my unbelief. But if on the other hand, we consider, is there another person involved in our salvation? Not just in acquiring, but in securing. How do we know that we not only have been saved, but that we stay saved even when our faith seems to peter out?
Right. And it's a great question, Mike, because obviously all of us want to have that assurance that we have salvation in God. And we all want to know that we're pleasing God, for we know in Hebrews 11, that it says, without faith, it is impossible to please God. We want to please him. We want to love him. We want to know him. And we want to be certain that we're going to be with him for all of eternity. I mean, what better question could we ask? And it seems like the question is predicated on someone who does understand that it is faith alone that saves them. But then the question becomes, how much faith do I need to be saved? And what is the quality of my faith that needs to be saved? It seems that's the real question that you're asking there, Mike. So let me read a quick passage, and then I'll get into these things with you. So this is 1 John 5, verse 10. It says, he who believes in the Son of God has this witness within himself. He who does not believe God has made him, meaning God, a liar, because he has not believed the testimony that God has given of his Son. And this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, that this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son does not have life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. Now, if you go through the entire book of 1 John, you know that this is not being written to perfect people. This is being written to people who are a mess, who need to grow in a lot of areas. Some of which, by the way, John really calls out as struggling with sin. He deals with a lot of different issues within this letter that are kind of severe, actually. But one of the things that he really harps on within this book is he harps on this idea of how do we know that we have salvation? He goes over it and reiterates it in many, many different ways. And one of the main ways that he's getting at is he's getting at this idea of having the Son of God. Now, what does he mean by having the Son of God? What he's getting at, and he really elaborates on this in 1 John 4, is he's saying, what is the whole purpose of salvation? What is it all about when it's all said and done? Yes, it's about going to heaven. Yes, it's about having your sins forgiven. Those things are a part of salvation, but what is really the main drive of salvation? And John gets it right here, and he says it throughout his letter. It's about having Jesus. It's about knowing him in a personal love relationship type of way. That's what it's all about. And so for John, what he's getting at here, what he's saying in this particular section about how we know that we have eternal life, is he's saying that it's all about having faith in the fact that we have Jesus Christ. We have a real love relationship with him, predicated on his finished work and not on what we have done. What does this mean in regard to your question? How much faith does it take to have the Son of God? Very simple answer, not much. We don't really need to have that much faith in the Son of God in order to have salvation. All we have to do is have a basic understanding and a belief in who he is and what he's done, and that enables us to take steps of faith, right? So basically, if you look at it, it's kind of like marriage. How many people, when they get married, have a real genuine idea of exactly what marriage is going to be like, exactly how faithful their spouse is going to be, exactly how things are going to work out? Not many. Did I really know for a certainty that my wife was going to be faithful for the rest of our lives? No. Did I know that things were going to work out, that our issues and problems that we had before marriage were going to be resolved, that they weren't going to get worse and result in our divorce? No, I didn't know any of that. But all I knew is that I truly, genuinely loved my wife, now wife, and that I wanted to spend the rest of my life with her. And I trusted enough of her character to be able to take a step of faith, to be able to say I do on that day. In the same way it works with God. How much did I really know about God when I gave my life to him? Not much. How much did I really know about what it meant to give my life to him? Again, not a whole lot. Very small, right? As Sean is saying, very, very small amounts. But what I knew is that I loved God and I wanted to take a leap of faith. I wanted to take a step out and believe in him for salvation. I believed in what he did. I knew that he had lived the perfect life that I should have lived. He had died the death that I deserved to die, and I wanted to be with him. And so I put my faith in him. It was a very, very small amount of faith that enabled me to take a step of faith. Same thing is true with the Christian. If you have faith that Jesus was a real person, that God is real, that Jesus died for your sins, but you're not willing to take a step, if you're not willing to say, well, in light of these things, I do want to invite Jesus into my life. I do want to make that confession of faith, both before men and before God. If you don't have enough faith to do that, then yeah, you don't have enough faith to be saved, because you're not willing to make those steps of faith. You're not willing to let God into your life. You're not willing to give your life to him. You're not even willing to trust what he did for you. So that's not enough faith. But if you did have enough faith, like I said, to just take that step out, it could have been very weak. Looking back on it, I see how weak my faith was the day I gave my life to God, but it was enough. It was enough to get me out there and to make that decision. So I hope that does help a little bit, but as Sean said, faith is something that continuously grows throughout the Christian life. We should always be praying like that man in Mark 9. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. I believe enough, like that guy, he believed enough to ask Jesus, but he knew, and that was a step of faith for him, but he didn't really know. He's like, I don't really know if you're going to come through right now, but I hope that you help my unbelief, God. I want to grow in my faith towards you because I see you. I see the kind of man you are. I want to be with you. I know that you're going to help my son. There are parts of me that doubt. Help those parts of me that doubt. And that's what we can pray in the same way. And if you are, you know, in sin, we're all in sin. We're all messing up, right? And yeah, that is a result of a lack of faith. That's ultimately a result of the fact that we don't have perfect faith in God. We don't have perfect trust in the riches of heaven, but that's okay. God can grow us in these things. We're just always taking those small steps of faith based on the faith that we have in Jesus Christ as he grows it and increases it by his power and through his Holy Spirit. But this is, it's always a work in progress. And whenever we have that question of like, do I have enough faith? Is more than likely you do. What you're seeing is you're seeing that there's a lack in your life, and there's nothing wrong with that. That lack is not a result of the fact that you're not saved. It's a result of probably the fact that you are saved, but you want to grow. And that's a very natural thing for a child of God to want to do. There's nothing wrong with that. Continue to pray for that increased faith. God will be faithful to you, and continue to work on those areas of your life that need help.
Yeah, don't despise the correction of the Lord. If you're experiencing feelings and doubts and all of these different things as a result of just where you're at in your life, even if it's just in a growing process, you're going to realize, oh, God doesn't chasten the neighbor's kid. This is proof that I belong to him. Because again, without the Holy Spirit, none of us would want salvation. That's straight out of Ephesians. No one comes to the Father unless the Lord calls him or the Spirit draws him. So if right. And that's in John. But if we're talking right. about these issues, we're first of all clarifying that one main point. If I am saved, if I'm still saved, well, if I'm not saved, I wouldn't care.
Right.
If I'm still saved, probably means I want it.
Right.
And if I am saved, well, the issue's really resolved then, isn't it? So that's what we're talking about. And again, I'm not laughing to make light of the situation, Mike, but when we're talking about these issues, just remember, we fall back on reality, not on feelings, not on circumstances. And again, feelings come and go. But when it ultimately comes down to it, the reality of who Jesus is and all that he went through to make salvation possible for you tells us at least enough about him to say he probably didn't make it that easy for us to break. That's, I think, a good point to fall back on. And also noting the issue of struggling in sin and still being saved in a relationship with God, but not necessarily enjoying it. I think this ties into Essay's question. And again, for audiences that may consider this uncomfortable, we're going to get into some honesty here. But Essay wants to know, From this honest guy, I heard a pastor today use Mark 5 to say that the man possessed in the beginning of the chapter cut himself and hung out in a cemetery. That if someone is into the macabre or self-mutilation, that they are under demonic oppression. That's another question all of on its own. Or possessed. That sounded pretty hokey and outdated to me. Yeah. And especially since the enemy often disguises himself as an angel of light. Was this pastor right? Well, SA, I would disagree with him, not just from my own experience, which is relevant, but also biblically. And let's start with that because, frankly, you shouldn't care. When we're talking about the issue of what you brought up, the preferred tactic of the enemy. He doesn't come in looking like, as my dad oftentimes says, a refugee from an Underwood's deviled ham can saying, oh, I'm the devil and I'm going to tempt you, looking like the pagan god Pan right. of the forest. The reality is that Satan is the accuser of the brethren. That's what his name means, an angel of light. And that is his preferred method of drawing people away from God, is to appear as a good thing. Problem is, in Galatians chapter 1, as well as the passage you cited in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, good things don't necessarily mean it's a good thing. It can be less than the best thing, especially when it's trying to distract you from the best thing, then it becomes a bad thing. If even an angel of light, Paul said in Galatians chapter 1, preaches to you any other gospel than what you have received, says, let him be accursed. Tell him to go to hell, literally, is the practical translation. Likewise, if we're going to then say, well, because this individual practiced these sort of things, this is therefore proof of demonic possession. Well, if you're going to make that a case, that if someone is possessed, they're going to show these kinds of symptoms, you'd have to see a consistent pattern. And if, say, for example, I'm going to look at other examples of possession in the Bible, King Saul was given a distressing spirit from the Lord because he severed his relationship with him, and that desperation was supposed to help call him back. But you wonder, okay, how did that manifest itself in Saul? Did he start listening to goth music and wear an eyeshadow and all that? No, he definitely became more hostile, and he started
he dug the heart, man.
Yeah. So was, anyway,
he liked David, man.
He was listening David's to good music. But it was I'm making jokes. The issue was just an outright hostility towards people who were supposed to be his friends. When he sought the counsel of the Witch of Endor, it wasn't because it had become a new hobby to him. It was because he couldn't get answers because he had murdered all the priests in Israel that hadn't fled and gone to David. So you're wondering then, what is the basis for saying that demonic possession is always because of some interest in the macabre and in cutting yourself? Well, interest in the macabre, and I'm very proud I'm pronouncing this properly, in hanging out in a cemetery, he wasn't doing that because he wanted to. The city drove him out because he was attacking people,
right?
Which is also probably a more consistent sign of demonic possession, and we're not denying that's possible. But if we fall back on Scripture and let Scripture interpret Scripture, and I say, okay, my position is that demonic possession can happen to people if they're expressing these sort of traits. Well, I've essentially just defined a disease, right? I've said, if they show signs of coughing, dry eyes, fever, sweating, that probably means they have a cold or a flu, and we should narrow that down to properly treat it. Well, if someone is interested in the macabre, self-mutilation, then that means that they are possessed. We should treat that accordingly. Well, Peter's looking at me here with quite a smug grin here, and noting that when I was dealing with certain issues of lust in my own life, there was another issue that was going on that I sought regular accountability from. And it was the issue of self-harm and mutilation. That is still an issue that I struggle with to this day. Now note, I am thankful to God that He has done a work in my heart where I haven't resorted to those methods of coping with my emotions in, how long has it been? Maybe 5 years? I'm very thankful for that. But when we're talking about this issue, the first and greatest example of a prohibition against this, I think, is very telling. It's in Leviticus chapter 19 and verse 28, where it says, you shall not cut yourselves for the dead or tattoo your bodies, I am the Lord. Mm-hmm. Now, this is the proof text that many go to and say, well, this is a prohibition against tattoos. A motive is being ascribed here. And if you're going to talk to anyone who struggles with self-harm in any way, note, music interest, makeup, the gothic culture, and all that sort of stuff may or may not be a part of it. You could look at me and say, apparently not even then. But then you ask the question, why were they cutting themselves? Well, I had given my life to the Lord when I was 11 years old. And so if that was the starting point, the basis for where I was currently in my life, I wasn't harming myself until probably 2 years after that. And I didn't really see any legitimate steps of victory until I started cutting, full ironic, I know, but removing things from my life, such as making sure that my parents had access to and withholding from all of our kitchen knives, and that if I ever came in possession of a lighter, and again, fair warning, because this is going to be graphic and honest, they had to have that in their possession. I couldn't handle having those things around me. God made progress in my heart, but you would never look at that time in my life and say, this kid's demon-possessed. Because A, I had a relationship with God before this. It wasn't undone, and as a result, I started cutting myself. B, the symptoms and cause of my self-mutilation was, as Leviticus would note, a sign of mourning for people who didn't have a relationship with God because of all the things that were going on in our lives at the time. That was just how I found distractions and coping. We looked to other methods as well, but it ultimately was fruitless and produced some nasty fruit as a result as well. Again, I won't get into those kind of details, but when we're talking about these issues, to say then that if this is there, then this is taking place, you have to be very specific, not just right. Look at a general example and say, well, in Mark chapter 5, there was a guy who did this, therefore anyone doing this is that. You can't make that basis, because first and foremost, we can look at scripture and say, demonic possession, they're pretty hostile. In the book of Acts, the guys who tried to cast them out in the name of Paul and Jesus, or Jesus whom Paul preaches, and he says, Paul I know, Jesus I know, but who are you? And he didn't start cutting himself and right. hanging out in the cemetery. He attacked them,
right.
beat them senseless, and drove them out of the building naked. I yeah. won't ask further questions, but yeah. the issue is, if you're going to say this, A, you're providing an incredible level of discouragement to people who are already dealing with enough.
Right.
Second, in the biblical taking of this and basically missing the whole point of
right.
the passage,
right.
because we look at the guy who is struggling with these things outside of Gadarene, and he ends up being essentially the first evangelist, if you don't count the Samaritan woman.
Yeah.
He had a spiritual walk with God that was leaps and bounds ahead of where the apostles even would be in the book of Acts.
Right.
He told them to go and tell the wonderful things that God has done in your life. And if we then take that and say, well, I guess that was a good thing, he got delivered of his demon, this is where this doctrine comes in, the idea of demonic oppression as opposed to possession.
Right.
That demons can be influencing your life and coaxing you into cutting yourself, coaxing you into wanting to hang out in a cemetery instead of just looking for peace and quiet. Apparently that's a bad thing.
Yeah.
But coaxing you to these sort of things, that demons can influence you even if you're saved. Why would we disagree with that?
Right. So there's a huge reason why we disagree with that. And just to reiterate something that Sean's been saying, and it's incredibly simplistic, incredibly reductionistic, and even, I would say, dangerous to have this view of people who do self-harm or do mutilate and saying that you're demon-possessed. Because like Sean said, you're taking one particular thing and you're saying this is then going to be symptomatic of everyone who's demon-possessed, and that's just simply not true. So you could be taking someone who, like Sean, someone in Sean's position who was saved, did love God, struggled with some things both mentally and physically that caused him to move in this direction. Now you're saying, you're not saved, you're demon-possessed. And that's like, it's not only going to make them feel like, oh my gosh, like, I guess I'm not saved, I guess there is something. It's going to totally screw that person up. There are a myriad of reasons of why someone might choose self-harm, right? Tons of reasons, actually. There's not just one simple reason. So it's very important that you use things like this with caution. Beyond that, the reason why demon oppression is something that we really steer away from is because, first of all, most important, it's not biblical. There is nothing in the Bible that suggests that you could be oppressed by a demon as someone who's saved. Now, it is true that what we see throughout the Bible is we see that Satan and his demons, they can influence if you want to put it that way. They can't influence, much like Christ in the wilderness, right?
Or Job, right?
So Satan can influence you via circumstances in your life, right? Like what Paul says in 2 Corinthians 12, a messenger of Satan was sent to buffet me, right? Which actually means to beat him in a sense, right? So what he's saying is that Satan puts something in his life to jack him up, basically, to cause suffering or something like that, some sort of a temptation or trial inside of Paul's life, right? Satan can do that. Satan can do, as Sean said, Job, like allowing some sort of a calamity or suffering to enter into your life. Satan can do that. Satan can do something like in Genesis 3 with Adam and Eve, tempting them, whispering, essentially. That's essentially what he does most of the time. Satan can accuse you. That's again what Sean said. That's what his name means. He's the accuser. He's the someone who makes you feel less than, someone who points at you and says you're nothing, right? God can't love you, things like that. Satan can do that. He can whisper. But this idea of oppression goes a little bit deeper than that. So if that's all someone means when they say you could suffer demonic oppression or influence, if all they mean is that, yes, there are, you know, Satan can tempt you, he can do things like that, if that's all they meant, hey, I'm on board.
Yeah, there's three kinds of opposition: the world, the enemy, and our flesh.
Right.
We don't deny the second one is a reality.
That's right. Right. Even Peter says, devil goes about like a roaring lion, right? Seeking whom he may devour. So yeah, we agree. We believe that. Absolutely. But that's not what they mean, right? When they say demonic oppression, it seems that there's very little difference between what they call demonic possession and oppression. It seems pretty similar.
Yeah, you're lightly possessed.
Right, yeah, it's like being lightly possessed, which sounds very weird. You know, it's like you have all the symptoms of possession, essentially, when you look at it. You have all the symptoms of possession, you're just not exactly possessed because you are saved and there's some sort of distinction there. It's really odd, it gets really hairy at some point. And it makes it difficult to diagnose. It makes it difficult to help someone out. But essentially, the cure for demonic oppression, which once again, it's not biblical. It's nowhere in the Bible. No one has ever been able to show me a place in the Bible where it talks about demonic oppression. Because the cure to demonic oppression is the same thing. Exorcism. You must exorcise this demon. So again, I would have to ask someone who believes like this, like, what do you mean by demonic oppression? If someone is being essentially controlled by this demonic presence and they have to be exorcised this demonic presence, in what way does this differ from demonic possession? It seems like it's the same exact thing. And it's very odd. It's very weird. And like I said, it's a damaging, very damaging thing to say to someone, especially if you have someone who is struggling with this thing and you're saying, oh, you have like demonic oppression or you have demonic possession in your life, when that might not even be the case, right? They might be struggling in a way where they're cutting on themselves because they've had a really, really rough life. And they have so much internal pain and turmoil that they don't know how to express it properly. And so they use self-harm as a means of expression. Maybe they do have some sort of a mental illness that is contributing to their desire to self-harm. And again, the list goes on and on and on. And just by saying you have demonic oppression, I'm going to pray this out of you, that's not going to be helpful to them. It might be actually more harmful to them. You need to really, really check to see what's going on. And I also like this passage. I'm going to read this passage real quick because I like it, and it catches people off guard sometimes. This is 1 Timothy 4, verse 1. Now the Spirit expressly says that in latter times, some will depart from the faith, giving heed to deceiving spirits and doctrines of demons. And you're like, ooh, what's he about to say? Is he about to talk about going to cemeteries and playing with Ouija boards? And, you know, and that's kind of what we think when Paul gives us his heads up, man, deceiving spirits, doctrines of demons, this is going to be crazy. Listen to what he says. Speaking lies and hypocrisy, having their own conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from foods which God created to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and know the truth. What is this doctrine of demons that we should be so afraid of in the latter times? Not allowing people to marry and forbidding certain foods.
You're lying in hypocrisy.
And lying in hypocrisy. You're like, that doesn't really seem demonic to me. But I like how you said it, Essay, that it says that Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. Now, when you look at the majority of people, what are the most harmful doctrines that are around the world right now? Is it Ouija boards and witchcraft and sacrificing goats to Satan and all this stuff? Is that really what's doing the most damage in this world right now? No. Right? But there are certainly religions, right? One of the biggest ones I could think of right now would be Islam, right? Huge, huge religion that's right now all over the world and it's causing massive amounts of destruction. these people aren't playing with Ouija boards. They aren't doing something like that. They're not hanging out in cemeteries. Some of them might be, but you know, they're not hanging out in cemeteries doing stuff like that. They believe in God. They believe that it's good to live a holy life. They pray five times a day. They're doing all these holy things. And this is exactly what Paul's warning is about. He's saying in latter times, there's going to be a doctrine of demons that's going to teach what? Abstinence and purity. And this abstinence and purity is actually going to be driving more people away from God than these more blatant knockoffs of what we would call Satanism or demonism that you would call.
Even Satanism is just glorified hedonism. Do what you want. And by the way, fooey on Christians. Right. Anton LaVey wasn't trying to worship Satan. He was just trying to live the hippie lifestyle.
That's right. He was just trying to stick it to Christians by saying, oh, we worship the devil. But
yeah, there are people who do that, and they're called Luciferians. Mm-hmm. But even then, it's basically a sad science fiction.
Right.
When we're talking about these issues, though, biblically, you can't support that, because if you set up this symptom for the disease, you can't apply that consistently. Mm-hmm. If you even look at the Old Testament law and ask, why was cutting forbidden? It mm-hmm. was expressed because of grief.
Right.
And because the people of Israel grieved with hope, they shouldn't do this to honor their relatives.
Right.
Or to just express emotions and pain. If you run into someone who's struggling with these sort of issues, of which still am, you're obviously not going to look at someone who's not saved. You're looking at someone who is struggling with their flesh in some very tangible ways. Mm-hmm. And whether it's with lust and pornography, whether it's with cutting and self-harm, whether it's with lying, whether it's with stealing, whether it's with any bad and self-destructive habit, it ultimately is solved by bringing the darkness into the light. Mm-hmm. A consistent form of accountability, a desire for Jesus, and well, I can honestly say it's worked so far. That's what we really need to focus on. So, essay, I would say that pastor, and I'm glad you didn't mention his name, but whoever they were way off base and starting to get into something very unhelpful
right.
to those who are struggling with this. If you like hanging out in cemeteries, again, probably peace and quiet might give you a good time to reflect. Jesus hung out at a graveyard when he was spending time raising Lazarus from the dead. It didn't mean that Jesus was possessed. And likewise, the guy who was cutting himself, it was probably because he was going through some stuff dealing with a legion of demons in his head.
Yeah.
That's all that we should take away from that. And especially what he took away from that, which was Jesus. And that's the whole point. Got a question here from a different Sean who wants to know about the sermon that you gave on Sunday. Is the note still fresh in your mind before we elaborate?
Yeah, I gave two sermons on Sunday, though.
All right. The question is regarding the point on payment at the end of the sermon about the husband not emptying out the trash, the example that you gave there. Mm. He wanted you to elaborate on the debt aspect. I want to make sure you know what he's talking about.
Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So
I gave a sermon on Sunday about blessed are the merciful, which is one of the Beatitudes. And so as part of the sermon, I wanted to talk about bitterness, wrath, and forgiveness. And in order to do that, I brought up a very amazing parable that Jesus gives in Matthew chapter 18. In this parable, he gives an analogy to bitterness as being a type of debt, right? So the metaphor that he gives is it's of a servant owing a master a large quantity of money. I think it was 1,000 talents, which in modern day currency would be like $1 million or something like that. It would be a couple million dollars. It would be a lot of money. So he owes the master an amount of money that he can never pay. The master ends up forgiving him because he begs for mercy and the master gives it to him. And then he goes out and finds a fellow servant who owes him a certain amount of denarii. A denarii was like a day's wage. So I think if you calculated that in modern day currency, it would be maybe a couple $100s. Yeah. Not near as much as what he owed. And
Something
you'd like back. It would be nice to have that back, but it's not something that's going to break him. It's not something that's going to destroy him. But when his fellow servant says, hey, man, give me some more time. I just need some more time in order to pay you back. He puts him in a chokehold, sends him to debtor's prison, and says, you will pay me everything you owe. When the master gets wind of this, he gets very upset with his servant that he showed so much forgiveness and mercy towards. So he takes him and puts him into prison until he pays the master everything he would owe. Now, the point of that sermon is to demonstrate the kind of logical standpoint of forgiveness for the Christian. It's like if you've been forgiven this much by God, right, where you owed God your life, you owed God everything in your life to go to hell for all of eternity, and God is able to forgive you for that by himself taking on the debt through his son, then why wouldn't you be able to forgive someone else who only owes you a temporary amount, right? A small amount in comparison to the eternal debt that you owe God. Why wouldn't you be able to forgive that one, that person, just the smaller amount? So that's more the point of the parable. But what I took out of that parable, another point that I took out of that parable, is that bitterness can be like debt in that it accumulates over the years. So I use the analogy of a husband and a wife, and the wife asking the husband to take out the trash. So in the beginning of the marriage, right, and I do a lot of marriage counseling. So in the beginning of the marriage, maybe the wife is saying, "Hey, husband, can you please take out the trash?" And the husband says, "Oh yeah, sure, I'll get to that." And then he goes and he sits on the couch. He starts watching a game. He starts playing a video game. He starts talking to a friend, something like that. He gets distracted. He forgets. He goes to bed. It doesn't happen. So the wife wakes up the next morning. She sees the trash is still there. She rolls her eyes. She maybe lets out a very annoyed sigh. All right, and she says, "I guess I'll take out the trash," in that kind of passive-aggressive way. She takes out the trash, and the husband is none the wiser. He doesn't know that he forgot. It just totally slips his mind. Now, in the grand scheme of things, if bitterness really is like debt, that would be the equivalent of maybe like $5 debt, right? That's like the husband taking out like a 5-spot from his wife. You could deal with a 5-spot. You could deal with $5 worth of debt. It's not a big deal. But over the course of the marriage, the husband continues to do this over and over and over again for years. Now, after a couple years, when the wife asks the husband to do something, no matter what it is, whether it's taking out the trash, taking care of the kid, cleaning up something, doing a dish, something like that, and the husband doesn't do it, the reaction of the wife seems to get more and more intense. Now, the reason why this reaction is becoming more intense is because this debt has been accumulating over the years. So now when he's taking out this little 5-spot, he's taking out $5 more of debt in an account that's already overdrawn by $100,000. And so the wife is reacting to not just this $5 that he's taken out, she's reacting to the hundreds of thousands of dollars of metaphoric bitter debt that is accumulated over the years. So that is why throughout our lives, when we're in a relationship with someone, it's necessary to have continuous forgiveness. You need to continuously forgive people over and over and over again. That's why Jesus says, if your brother comes to you 7 times in one day and asks for forgiveness, forgive him if he's repented, meaning if he's truly genuinely sorry about what he's done and he's truly genuinely trying to change his behavior. Jesus says, forgive him over and over and over again. He doesn't say, look at that person who's repentant coming to you and saying, "Hey, I'm so sorry," and looking at him and saying, "No big deal, don't worry about it," which is what we tend to do. That's not forgiving. Right, forgiving is being able to take what that person owes you, that emotional debt that they've just pulled out in your life by hurting your feelings, by undercutting something that you've done, by nagging you, by harming you, by not listening to you, or whatever it is that they're doing. To take that injustice, to take that debt, to bring it before God and say, "God, in light of everything you've forgiven me for, help me to forgive this person. Help me not to excuse their behavior," meaning to just overlook it, but instead to take this anger that I have towards them, look to you, and trust your judgment in their life, that you're going to deal with them as they need to be dealt with. Help me not to become the arbitrator of this debt. Help me not to become passive-aggressive, vengeful, vindictive, and arrogant towards this person in this relationship. Help me not to accumulate this debt over the years, but help me just in this moment by your Spirit to forgive this person. And if you got to pray an imprecatory prayer in the moment, go ahead and do it. And by the way, imprecatory prayer, it means a cursing prayer. We have examples of them in the Bible where the psalmists just go before God and they say, "God, I'm really angry at this person. I hate this person. Bring vengeance upon their life." And they start asking God for specific judgments in this person's life. Some of them are actually really hardcore, right? Now, what they're doing is they're saying, "God, this is what I would do in this situation, but I'm not you. Help me to trust in your judgment. Do what is right in this situation and help me to forgive them. Help me to love this person as opposed to wanting to judge them." This is something that needs to happen in a relationship. If you're not doing this regularly, I guarantee you debt is growing and the bill is going to come due at some point. You will eventually break. No matter how patient you are, if you're married to someone for long enough or you're in a relationship with someone long enough and they perpetually do a behavior that bothers you, which they will, and you're not regularly forgiving them, eventually you're going to blow up on that person and it's not going to be pretty. So, you know, there's that saying, it's not from the Bible, but it's a true one. Keep short accounts. What does that mean? It means continuously be forgiving the people in your life. Make it a practice. That's why, by the way, Jesus, when he taught us how to pray, Remember the Lord's Prayer? Smack dab in the middle of it, what does it say? Forgive us our trespasses as what? As we forgive those who trespass against us. Jesus is assuming two things when he's teaching us how to pray. Every time you pray, you have something to ask forgiveness for, and you have something to ask forgiveness to, right? Meaning that you have something that you need to look to God and say, God, I need forgiveness for doing this thing. But you also have someone in your life that you need to forgive. Almost every time you pray, both those things are going to be true. So if you're, again, if you're in a long-term relationship with someone, I guarantee you they have behaviors in their life that are sinful. That's the flaw of being in a relationship with a flawed person. And that means they need forgiveness. They need constant forgiveness. Otherwise, these things will build. They will boil over. I've seen it happen time and time again as a marriage counselor where you're counseling these people and I'm like, hey, what'd you guys get into a fight about? And it's about the smallest, almost seemingly stupid thing you could possibly imagine, right? The husband is like, yeah, my wife the other day, she doesn't respect me. She never respects me. She never did blah, blah, blah. And he goes off on this rant. I'm like, well, what did she do? And he says, well, you know, I was asking her about what she thought about my new job and she just sighed and she didn't give me an answer. And I said, that's what you're pointing to? That's the thing that sent you into this overdrive of emotion and made you leave the house and start drinking? Like, that's what happened? And the reason why is because it's not what she said. It's the pattern. It's the pattern that's been going on in the marriage that caused that massive overreaction. It's because the husband has not been clearing the account. He has not been coming to God in humility and asking for the power of forgiveness. He thinks he could do it in his own strength. He thinks he could just let things go in his own power. It doesn't work, and it becomes massively horrible. So that's what I meant in that sermon. I hope that makes sense. If you have a follow-up question, please let me know.
Yeah, let's know if that helps you out, Sean. Now, it's been too long since we've gotten to this issue. I figured, why not end the broadcast on it? The question here, we aren't given a name, but it is on a familiar topic, the Nephilim. referring to the fallen ones, that's the word Nephilim means in Hebrew. And the individual basically wants clarification on the controversy because there's two and completely biblically supported and established positions that Christians are allowed to deal with. However, we find ourselves on one side of them. We try to do this when the elder and I were on here. We'll alternate and let's say, we want to make sure that if we disagree with the position, we've at least heard it out. Right. So we'll take turns in representing the other side. Which would you like to, or do you want me to just go schizophrenic here and answer my own objections?
I'll take the side of demon hybrids. Okay. I like that side.
All right. So go ahead and give us the idea that the Nephilim are the, and this is one of the theories, the biological offsprings on the basis of sons of God in Genesis chapter 6. And this is where the topic's first introduced. In Genesis chapter 6, it says, the sons of God saw the daughters of men that they were beautiful, and they went into them, and sons were born to them. So they married, they had children. Mm-hmm. And it emphasizes that. They took them in marriage, correct?
That's right.
So in that position then, this, what are the biblical supports for it? That the sons of God would be referring to angels in this.
Right. So I don't believe this, by the way.
Yeah, but we're presenting both sides, so you know we've at least heard this out. We love our brothers who take this position.
Right.
We just disagree, and it's not a salvation issue.
That's right. So someone who takes this position would say, well, in Genesis chapter 6, it says that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, as Sean just said, and they would look at it and say, well, why is there a distinction between sons of God and daughters of men? And they would look through the Bible, and they would say, when is this term sons of God used? And there is an instance where this word, this phrase, sons of God, is used to describe angelic beings. In Job, it says that the sons of God came in and out of the throne room of God. And so they would look at that and say, hey, this is clearly referring to angelic beings. Beyond that, at the end of the passage, it does say that these people were mighty men of renown. So why would these offspring be basically physically, seemingly genetically superior to those around them to be heroes of old? You know, wouldn't that insinuate that they have some sort of maybe a semi-divine heritage within them? Beyond that, many of the old and ancient pagan kings believed that they were descendants of God. So gods. So wouldn't that make sense that, hey, you know, there was some demonic being that did at some point have intimacy with a woman and produce this weird genetic offspring. Beyond that, in Jude, it says that that these angels with after strange flesh. By the way, that's a misquoting of that passage. But anyway,
they left their proper abode, and then the further confirmation is then he goes on to give the example of Sodom and Gomorrah,
right,
who indulged in sexual immorality. Now, they would equate the two, right?
Right. That's right. So they would say that the angels went after strange flesh because they're equating the two, Sodom and Gomorrah and angels leaving their proper abode. As well as in 2 Peter, it says similar things and says that these angels are now basically in Tartarus or some other form of hell because of their falling from grace with God.
And then the filling in the gap, the answer to the question as to why, well, the Bible wouldn't discuss something unless it was earlier specified, unless it explained it right away.
Right.
It didn't. So they would presume and go to Genesis 6 and say this was the incident. This
right.
is where angels interfered with the deeds of men.
Right.
So you gave passages, Job chapter 1 and chapter 3. You gave Jude. And
yeah.
Of course, in Genesis 6, you're applying that principle. And again, there were other kings like this too. We can look at historical examples like the pharaohs of Egypt thought they were descendants of Ra. They said they were an incarnation of Horus, mm-hmm. the son of Ra. They would say, for example, Sihon and Og were considered Nephilim, that they
right.
inhabited Canaan, which will be in favor of my case in a second. The counterpoint to this, and just so you know, there are people who take these positions and do so while still being legitimate Christians.
Right.
My father, Peter, and I, we do not take this position, and here's why. First and foremost, if we're going to go to the scripture, like the those who are against this position, they're going to do so because of the whole message of scripture. And the biggest nail in the coffin when it comes to the sons of God equals angels interpretation is first and foremost a careful reading of Genesis chapter 6, where it says that they, in verse 2, the sons of God saw the daughters of men, they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves. So wives is being put here. Well, I assume that Jesus knows something about the heavenly realm. And in Matthew chapter 22 and verse 30, Jesus was addressed about the resurrection, given the Sadducees' classic debunking passage, and he says, "For in the resurrection they," referring to us, "neither marry nor are given in marriage, but are like the angels," not the sons of God, "the angels of God in heaven." So if angels, we have a doctrine here, are excluded from the covenant of marriage. They don't marry, just like we won't marry when we're in heaven. That model and comparison then would tie us back to this and say, because daughters of men and sons of God are distinct from one another, it wouldn't be accurate to say the sons of God distinction means they were angels. Why? Well, there's plenty of other examples of people who are sons of God, and it's a relational term. Because note, just like in Job chapter 1, it says the sons of God came, present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also among them. There was a distinction because Satan did not have a relationship with God. Who were the sons of God? We believe in the immediate prior chapter. Genesis chapter 5 gives us the godly line of Seth. Those who had a relationship with God began marrying ungodly spouses, the daughters of men, and it ultimately caused not a corruption in the gene seed, but necessarily, but a compromise in relationships that made the relationship with God and mankind almost non-existent, and then the flood took place. Also, Nephilim were still around after Joshua, so if the flood was to wipe them out, God missed. God bless
you. You've been listening to A Reason for Hope. Thank you again for joining us as we continue our journey through God's Word, one question of the heart at a time. Until we meet again, we would love to connect with you. You can text or email your questions to questionsforhope@gmail.com. You can also find out more about our ministry at calvarychristianfellowship.com. And be sure to join us next time on A Reason for Hope. A Reason for Hope is an outreach ministry of Calvary Christian Fellowship in Tucson, Arizona.